Good morning, everyone, and thank you, Creative Mornings, for the invitation. I think it's amazing you all showed up so early to hear me talking about heritage. So, it's an interesting theme because heritage is something, the word itself always feels a bit like dull and distant. But in my daily practice, I bump into the word and the concept of heritage a lot. I work a lot with museums, but also the public space. And if you deal with museums, the public space, the historic city, trying to make exhibitions or program cultural events, it's not a blank canvas. There's always a history you have to deal with. So I was thinking, like, heritage, okay, I can, you know, present you some projects I have been working on, and I will do that. But then I suddenly bumped into something else, and I thought, no, I should also start a bit more personal. So I will talk about how I'm dealing with heritage through cryptic shout-outs, while heritage is yours, and today is the shadow of tomorrow. Very cryptic beginning of what I want to tell you, but hopefully it makes sense at the end of this short talk. I kind of changed the talk because last week I bumped into a YouTube video called Icy Lake, and I thought it is a lot about heritage. The video starts with the following sentences. Icy Lake, it's a peculiar mid-90s dance song built on a tribal house beat and designed as a rally call for folk dance battles and runway performances. Almost two decades ago, since Icy Lake was first produced, the song is now being re-released by record labels Night Slugs and Fade to Mind after the chance discovery of the song at the end of an obscure YouTube clip. What follows is a 15-minute music documentary, basically, about a group of people, about actually this guy you see here, a DJ Total Freedom, who was also on YouTube, like I am sometimes, and he saw this video of a dance party from the 90s, and he was just watching it. So someone filmed that dance party in the 90s, and someone decided to put it on YouTube. And he was watching that, and he suddenly, in the middle of this recording, heard a song. And immediately he thought, wow, this is such an amazing song. It really relates to the music I'm making right now. And he wanted to know more about that song. And apparently the song is called Icy Lake. And what he did with the label is re-releasing that song. So you can now again buy that song on vinyl or on MP3. But what they also did is that they really went looking for the history of that particular song. So who made it? What are the people doing now? What was the context of that party? Who were at that party? How is it, why is that song so obscure? Why don't we know about it? But also, how does it relate to grime music from the early 2000s, or how does it relate to what he's doing right now? And for me, that is about heritage. It's very obscure, but the idea that someone found that particular party so important, you want to put it on YouTube and share it with more people, and then that later someone else discovers that video and decides, hey, I want to know more about those 2 minutes, and digging deeper into that history, for me, that is a lot about heritage. And it also, another example of this, and these are kind of cryptic shout-outs, as they call them. They may be very obscure. Maybe there are 2 people here now that understand what I'm talking about, but for me, that's fine. Another one is the radio shows of the Electrifying Mojo. He was a DJ in Detroit, who had a radio show in the 80s, and it became a very important radio show because he was playing a certain kind of music that was not really played then. So for instance, he would find German electronic music by Kraftwerk, and he was playing that on a Detroit radio show, and he was the first one to do that. And he inspired a lot of people who are now, you know, techno DJs from Detroit with this German music he was playing in his radio show. And again, this was just one guy with one radio show. But again, people started to record those shows on tapes and passing them along to friends. And now you can go to YouTube and listen to those radio shows. So it's again a group of people who found something so important that they record it, put it on another medium, put it on YouTube, and that is how you preserve heritage, like musical heritage in this sense. The first time I heard about him was because I was watching a music documentary made by the VPRO, the Dutch broadcasting company. I think also around 2003, they interviewed him, and he wanted to stay anonymous because he said the only thing that's important was that I was a voice on the radio. And it was broadcasted on national television. And again, someone saw that broadcast and thought, wow, this is an important document. I'm also going to put it on YouTube. And that's how I found it. So these are some of my my records at home before I was going to DJ somewhere. All of these records have a history and have a story, have connotations to a certain country, a certain group of people. And for me, there are a lot of codes in that. And I think that also influences the way I work. I make a radio show every week on a red light radio, and it's in the middle of the red light district. As you can see here, I'm every week standing behind this window while some of my neighbors are still prostitutes. So it's first I had to get used to it a little bit, but I do this show for 3 years now every week, so it's kind of like a natural environment. But my show is called Future Vintage, and it's this kind of contradiction that I want to play music that's very old, very new, but make connections and trying to have be aware of the history, but creating something new with it. And I think this kind of relates to my other work as well. So being a DJ is also about making a sharp selection, combining things in a mix, and maybe that's what I do in my other work that relates more to museums and culture in Amsterdam. This image came, I think, an iconic image. It's Bas-Jan Ader, an artist who drove into the canals on purpose in 1970, and he made a video out of this. It's called Fall. You can also find it online. It's very beautiful. I think it's an interesting image because it's pretty loose and it makes you see the canals maybe in a different way. Just like I like to refer to this image as well. It's the same canal area of Amsterdam, but then in the early 80s, when a lot of the canal houses were squatted by people, it's very hard to, if you're cycling there now, to imagine that once, Bas-Jan Ader was just driving into the canal, but also once a lot of these canal houses were empty or taken over by squatters. But I think it's good to be reminded of that sometimes. Especially last year, when Amsterdam celebrated the 400 years of the canal area. And not only that, also 125 years of the Concertgebouw. There were a lot of celebrations of kind of historic events. I think what was very surprising that they used the image of Bas-Jan Ader, this kind of contemporary artist in his time in the 70s, for their campaign about 400 years of the Amsterdam Canal. I was very happy with that, because I think sometimes we think of Amsterdam, especially the canal area, of this kind of beautiful historic inner city, because it became very pretty compared to 70s, 80s, or maybe earlier on even, especially since the historic inner city is UNESCO World Heritage, and it became UNESCO Heritage in 2010. And it's also, together with some colleagues, I was thinking, like, what does that mean when not a building becomes heritage, but a part of the city, what is the heritage then? Is that the street? Is that the structure of it, the design of it? Is it also what kind of people live there or the way we behave? Because if you think about another UNESCO World Heritage site that we all know, Venice, for instance, it's also a whole part of the city that became UNESCO heritage, but no one lives there anymore. It's all tourists or people who Airbnb their apartments. I think only 5% of Venice now is, only 5% is where people from Venice actually live. Like 95% is people like us visiting, going in and out. So you have this beautiful facade, beautiful buildings, but is that still a city? Or is it more like an open air museum? So with these kind of questions, together with architect Jarek Auberg and my colleague Michiel van Iersel, we started to think about that. Like, what does that mean for Amsterdam that we now become UNESCO World Heritage? Is there still a free space, an undefined space that is maybe not a monument yet, or can we still find gaps or some openness in this beautiful canal area? So we went looking for unclear space and we found some of those. But these spaces are extremely small. What you see here is a selection of sites in this canal area that we call tussenruimtes. It means in-between space. I like the Dutch word a bit more. These are alleys or entrances to houses that are closed off. So what you see is that they have a door and a piece of wall, but they are basically this kind of open space in between the canal houses. And we thought, you know, if everything is a monument, if everything is a facade, maybe these are the only like leftover spaces we can claim somehow, or we can try to open again. So what we did is that we just rang the doorbell at people's houses or sent letters like, hey, we saw you have this space in between these two houses. Is it yours? Can we do something with it? Can we just see it? And we got a lot of great responses. Like, some people didn't respond at all. But it was quite interesting because some of these spaces are actually used, so people park their bicycle there. There was even a student house, they built a bathtub, like not on the floor, but a bit higher in between the houses they had, because they didn't have a room for a bath in their small bathroom, so they built it outside. But because we got kind of, we were invited to see those spaces, you suddenly see, hey, it's not a 17th century facade. The city has always been moving and changing, because if you go in an alley like that, you suddenly see that buildings are changed, things are renovated, restored, things are demolished. Maybe an entrance that used to be an entrance to a house is now a wall. So it kind of shows you that, no, the 17th century canal ring didn't stood still since the 17th century. So these are the spaces that we found. They're all like slivers of the city. It's not that much. Like, most of them are just an alley like this. You can just walk in it and that's it. But they're very high, of course, because the canal houses are pretty tall. Some of them go to a hidden garden, so they're a bit bigger. But we found 56 of those unclear, undefined spaces in the canal area, in the UNESCO zone. And we started to invite artists and architects to do something there, to do interventions, trying to see what space is this, what can we do with it. So here you see an artist from Sweden who lives in Amsterdam for quite a long time already, Monica Tormel. And she was digging a well in a hidden garden at the tussenruimte at the Krijtberg Church. And it became this, it's a bit hard to photograph, but it became this well that has been painted inside, and it gives you this like very like deep feeling, and it became a place to go. So that garden that was always closed off, like the Krijtberg Church, the people said, yeah, we have some land there, but we never go there, suddenly became a destination. And we would do little tours there or play some music. And it became a space again. Another intervention was this one at the Herengracht by Jarek Alburg, who's an architect. And yeah, what he did is that he asked the owner of the house, like, can we get your space for a while? Because he wanted to make like almost a space with a certain different atmosphere than the rest of the city. And it is this 10 meter high fabric that he put there, lots of layers. And inside, from the outside, you just see this white fabric. But once you walk inside, you have to go through all these layers of fabric. And then you become part of this, he called it a silence chapel. It's almost Japanese, very different. And the thought of that you just, you know, where you always cycle along the canals, but then suddenly you can just disappear, like going a bit like down the rabbit hole, like Alice in Wonderland style, made you see the city in a very different way. So people liked it a lot. We couldn't always open it. We opened it during the day at certain hours because it was still a private space and you don't want people maybe to live there. But I remember that I had the key, and one night I went out with a friend, and then later I thought, yeah, I have this key, you know, we can go to the Tussenruimte. And it was such a great feeling that you have this beautiful city and then you have a key and you can just sneak in and be in that free open space. Not everyone liked it that much. We got also some criticism of a group called the Vrienden van de Amsterdamse Binnenstad, which means the friends of the historic inner city. Well, they call themselves the friends of the historic city, but we sometimes call them the heritage mafia, because they are very, everything you change is a problem. Like everything should look like it always was. So even if you just put a fabric there, just this tiny, tiny sliver of a city, and you claim that, you get a lot of comments from them, because they are just, I have the feeling they have people like watching and just cycling through the city like, oh, where did someone change something? So in the end, we got a letter of the city saying, hey, you did something illegal over here. You cannot just change the door there, and you cannot just put 10 meters of fabric in an alley, even if that alley is not in use at all. And even if the owner says it's fine, you just cannot do that. Okay, yeah. I think if we would ask for a permit, it would have probably cost me a year to get it. So we were thinking, well, it's a temporary intervention. So we said, the funny thing was, we got some funding for this project from the city as well, but from a different department. So it's also pretty interesting. So yeah, we explained the situation. And then they said, well, if you complain about our complaint, it probably takes 6 weeks for us to respond again. And I was like, okay. It's okay, because this was meant as a temporary summer intervention. I said, I will wait for those 6 weeks. So we complained back, it got delayed. And because of that, we could have this space for 2 months. So it's, yeah, sometimes you just have to do things. But we wanted to address this. This was also a goal of the project, to see like where are the boundaries, what can you have and not, what can you do in a heritage environment. We did a lot of smaller things, like tours, performances. Here you see, this is like a little note Celine Talens made. She's a theater maker, and she wanted to do something with the history of squatting in Amsterdam. So just like squatters used to do, she made these little notes and gave them to people and saying, we meet there and there. Be reminded to cover your face, and we'll squat something. She went squatting a tussenruimte with a lot of, yeah, I think around 15 people showed up. And these are some of the images. I think heritage, it's yours as well. So don't be afraid to touch it or do something else with it. And that's something we wanted to address with Tussenruimte. And someone before was in the audience who was visiting some of these spaces asked me, like, so what are you going to do next? Well, we don't know yet. The main purpose of this was making people aware of it, so that you're now in the city and think, ah, yeah, there is Tussenruimte somewhere. It could be that we maybe later will do something more permanent and really work with an architect or a designer to think about the use of a space like that. But for now, it was more about more poetic interventions and thinking about between space and what that means for a city, that it's important to have this unclear space as well. Another project I'd like to mention that also relates a lot to the very old and the very new is a program I recently did at the Oude Kerk called Nieuwe Tijd voor de Oude Kerk, New Time for the Old Church. And it was a 12-hour long art marathon in the Oude Kerk. This is it. It's the oldest building of the city. It's 800 years old. In the middle of the Red Light District. I think most of you know it. If you haven't been inside, I recommend to go there, because it's one of my favorite spots in the city. And a lot of times people think, oh yeah, there's this church standing there. But it's very beautiful, very special. It is 800 years old. The floors are all graves. Even the wife of Rembrandt is buried in that church and is one of the graves. And what I like about it is that it's decorated, but also not. Because it started out as a Catholic church, and then after the Reformation it became a Protestant church. So it changed a lot, and the Maria statues were removed, just like this iconoclast time in the 16th century. But also later it always changed, and sometimes you see a church and you think, okay, this is it, but things have been added and or removed. And the church kind of shows it. We did some research. I was following Michiel here. We climbed on the roof. It was really nice. I'm happy it was a great day that day, but we were here on top of the roof. I went to see like all the corners and hidden spaces of that church. So you see, for instance, here the beautiful wooden ceiling with paintings on it. These paintings were covered. So later it was painted over, I think, with one color, and then people decided, oh, but there's actually some beautiful paintings on the wood underneath it, maybe show that again. So this is some of these changes that are, you know, part of the DNA of the building, basically. What I also like is somewhere, I think it was also close to the ceiling, a lot of people would write their names in the wood, but also in 1697. So we do it now, or people 10 years did it, but this is something people have done forever. And when you see that, you suddenly realize, yeah, you're just part of history. Like, people actually were doing things there. It was not just this building that is beautiful to watch, but it had a life. So the Oude Kerk has been renovated for 50 years. They're finished now. But again, then you think, okay, renovated, what does that mean? Is it brought back in the original state? And what is then the original state? And I mean, we could now say, yeah, the renovation is done, or restoration, I should say, sorry. The restoration is finished. Now we can just go there and keep it like that forever. But luckily, they have a new director who's coming more from the art world. And she was asked to come up with a art program for the Oude Kerk, which also got a lot of criticism. Again, the friends showed up again, saying like, why would you put contemporary art in the most beautiful old building of the city? It's also, I think, the idea that people have about contemporary art. You think immediately maybe of big installations or of abstract artworks on a white wall, but a lot of artists don't work like that at all. So we were asked to do something with that, and then we thought, okay, we can have a discussion about it, but maybe we should just invite artists and make them aware of the church, make them relate to the space. So we came up with this idea for a 12-hour art marathon from noon until midnight, where we were thinking about how to add what we are doing now to this historic building, how to add current time to the oldest building of the city. And I invited like all kinds of artists, musicians, but also the organ player of the church itself. So not only people from outside, but also people who are already working for the church, know the church very well. And everyone would get 1 hour, an hour of whatever they wanted to do. Of course, we discussed it, but we said, we are in the church. We don't have a lot of stuff here, like not a lot of technical possibilities, not a lot of budget also. So what would you do in an hour here? And I think, well, slowly people start thinking about it and came up with ideas. Some artists sent me this image that I like a lot for some reason, because he was just with paint trying to explain which part he wanted to use. And then after a while, we just did it on one day, noon until midnight, 12 hours. What I liked so much about it is that you have that church already, so there's already so much happening. So with pretty small interventions, people behave different in the church also. But with pretty small interventions, you can have a great effect. And also because it was so long, everyone asked me like, 12 hours, like when should I come? I want to be there, but what's the best part? And then I said, yeah, I'm sorry people, it's 12 hours. You can come whatever you want. You can also leave. We make this little, like a festival bracelet, so people could get in and out if they wanted. And it was of course a bit unclear, like it's not very audience friendly to do something for 12 hours and not tell people when they should show up. But it started with, for instance, during the day, two artists made a tour that this person is doing right now. It was called Tracking Traces. And it gave you little signs and codes how to move through the building and just lie on the floor and watch the ceiling, for instance, or go behind a wall where there was a hidden door and you could be in that wall. I never noticed that, but this artist did. And because of that, you start to see the church in a different way. There was also an artist who made a text that he usually records and then puts in a kind of media installation. But this time he asked this man to narrate the text, because the acoustics of the church are great. You don't even need a microphone there. And he was just telling this story and people were just following him through the church for a whole hour. They didn't leave also. So there was a very special way of concentration also going on. Like not like you would go into a gallery and watch something for 3 minutes and then continue. No, people were just walking with this man for an hour listening to a story. Then there was also the artist collective Beyoncé, that's their real name. They usually operate in a former, in Dutch you say snack bar, in the Baarsjes, in West. And I think they do some great things there, they're pretty young. And pretty hip also, but I said, why don't you want to do something in the church? And they thought, well, we want to do a fashion show then. I said, okay, it's fine. And I think this kind of was a really nice clash almost. They made this really hip Tumblr, especially for this, with called Jongens van de Wereld. Boys of the World, yeah. And they were doing a fashion show, but not just 5 minutes, and I did it for an hour. So they were posing in all parts of the church, and I think they were more relating to the aesthetics of it, like to the white space where they performed, for instance. So it was, the night continued, there was music, there were performances, and people were just meeting each other. People were also staying. I thought, okay, no one is going to stay that long. There were actually, I asked the photographer to make some images. I didn't have a lot of money, so I said, it would be great if you can photograph everything, but I understand you're not going to be there for 12 hours. And he said, nah, I will do something in between. And he didn't leave anymore. So he came in at 12 and at midnight he was still there. And also the minister of the church also arrived at noon and he was also still there at midnight and he loved it. So there was a very special energy going on. This is just before we quit, I think half an hour before it. And the nice thing, for the last hour I asked Orfeo, who is also the founder of Red Light Radio, and he's almost a neighbor of the church, I asked him to play music, and I said, you can be very experimental, you can do whatever you want, because we all thought, well, it won't be like a dancing party, because you're in a church. And so he started to play this kind of ambient experimental music, and people started to move on it. And then he thought for the last 20 minutes, oh, but people are going to dance maybe. And it became like 20 minutes of complete madness. This was just 5 minutes before that started. And people were throwing out their t-shirts and dancing like crazy people. Like I never experienced something like that. So I think all these things wouldn't happen if it would be a regular club if it would have been a regular museum, the fact that you are in a building with so much history and just a very different environment makes that I think other things can happen. But I think it was also very contemporary, because some people said, yeah, in this church we should only do historic things, or we should only do things that relate to the history of it. Well, maybe not. I think if you are in a space like that, you have to deal with it, like deal with the history of it, and you can do that in different ways. So this might become a new tradition. I mean, the church was very happy with it, so they already asked, like, would you do it again next year? We are also thinking about commissioning artists to make new works for the church, but maybe they don't have to be a statue or an object. Maybe they could be performances or new rituals for the space. So that's something I'm thinking about right now. And well, I hope this kind of gives you my kind of personal idea about how I'm dealing with heritage, because I think it's both the cryptic shout out to a 20-year-old obscure house track, because you want to share an historic context while creating something new. But it's also yours, I think. So you can claim a part of it, also when it means occupying a neglected alley in the middle of a UNESCO heritage area. And it's also not being afraid of dancing on graves that are 400 years old when you realize that same church might be there for another 400 years to come, so you should relate to it. Because today is the shadow of tomorrow. I hope that was inspiring. Thank you.